Hi guys, we're going to continue with theme 6. We've already had a look at, in the introduction, we saw how Robert Redfield spoke about two kinds of traditions, little tradition and great traditions, and how both little and great traditions, they came together, and this was called integration or coming together of different beliefs or cults. We then went on to have a look at an example of integration of cults, like in Puri, Orissa, Jagannath. We also saw tantric practices, how tantric practices were practiced under Hinduism, but they were a totally different idea compared to Orthodox Hinduism. We then went on to have a look at bhakti. We saw that bhakti emerged out of Hinduism, but it was a more tolerant form of worship and a more open sort of worship. And also here, praying to God actually meant becoming one with God. People were praying, people were dancing, almost like people are going in another trance altogether. Very importantly, women and people from lower castes could openly participate in the bhakti movement, which is very, very important, because Orthodox Hinduism was not allowing it. And if, in short, we want to have a look at Hinduism, we've already seen that it started as Vedic Hinduism when the four Vedas were written. And in Vedic Hinduism, the important gods were Som, Agni and Indra. Then, and because this Vedic Hinduism was very orthodox, very rigid, it underwent change to then become Puranic Hinduism, which was more open. Under Puranic Hinduism, the Puranas were written. These books were in easier Sanskrit, and women, lower caste, could also read them, or at least listen to them, which they were not allowed during the Vedas. Under Puranic Hinduism, the new gods were Vishnu and Shiva, so Vaishnavism and Shaivism. And the ideas of avatars come up. So the idea of avatar becomes very important, because in a way, that is integration of cults, as what Robert Redfield has said, because the dominant religion, Hinduism, will then give its god Vishnu different forms which were probably being practiced by people in the local areas. Again, Hinduism underwent a change to then see bhakti become a part of it. Now, bhakti was of two types, Saguna and Nirguna. Saguna was the one with attributes, where there was an idol, and in Nirguna, the worship was without idols. We then also had a look at bhakti in two states of South India, Tamil Nadu, where we saw Alvars and Nayanars, and in Karnataka, where we saw the Veera Shaiva tradition. We then saw religious fermentation in North India and Islamic tradition. So the other religion which underwent major change was Islam. Again, Islam became a very rigid orthodox religion, and a lot of people who followed it felt that they were moving away from the message of the Prophet. And so they started Sufism. Under Sufism, we've seen how the hospice or the kankha was important. The sheikh or the master stayed here. He had a lot of disciples, and it spread like a silsila. We are then going to move ahead. We saw chishti kankha. We're now going to have a look at devotionalism, which means how were Sufi practices being undertaken? How were they showing that they were devoted towards God, and how and what their methods were for praying? Now, pilgrimage was known as ziyarat. What is this pilgrimage? So Muslims do one pilgrimage to Mecca, where the Kaaba is there, the holy black stone. So the pilgrimage to Mecca is known as Hajj. Now people started doing pilgrimage to the tombs of these Sufi saints. These tombs were regarded as sacred. So when somebody made a pilgrimage to the tomb of a Sufi saint, that pilgrimage came to be known as a ziyarat. People went there to seek the Sufi's spiritual grace. The most revered Sufi saint was Khwaja Moinuddin. He got patronage of a lot of royal visitors, and one of the most famous ones was Sultan Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Again, it's very important to see that this is North India. But earlier when we had a look at bhakti for Tamil Nadu and Karnataka, those are two states in South India, we saw that the relationship with the government, with the rulers, with the kings was very good. The kings were giving them royal patronage, giving them money. But then we went on to have a look at the religious fermentation in North India, where people of lower castes came up with these bhakti ideas, but they did not do so well because they did not get royal patronage. However, with the establishment of the Delhi Sultanate and with the coming of Islam, and then Islam undergoing a change and becoming Sufism, we see that royal patronage was given to them. Khwaja Moinuddin has been mentioned in the texts of the 14th century, and he had a lot of spiritual successors. His tomb is on the route linking Delhi and Gujarat. In fact, he inspired Akbar a lot. Now, how was prayer done in Sufism? Prayer was being done through zikr. Zikr, like in Hindi you say zikr karna. So the zikr means calling out the divine name. And so when you do zikr, when you call out the divine name, you are evoking a type of an ambience, a sama. It would include a mystical performance through music. A lot of you, I'm not sure if you have gone, I'm sure you visited mosques, but I'm not sure if you've visited Qawwalis happening, and you definitely should. Or you could actually just listen to some music. Some very famous music, some very famous songs would be Bhar Do Jholi Meri, the one sung by Adnan Sami. You could all listen to that. So that song has a Sufi statement with it. I mean, that is the kind of music and the kind of wordings that were sung to evoke God, Allah. Then we have another example of Baba Farid, who was a Sufi saint, and he composed a lot of verses in the local language. Very interestingly, a new religion is going to come up, which is going to be Sikhism. Now, the Sikhism has a holy book. Now, Sikhs have a holy book called Guru Granth Sahib. The Guru Granth Sahib is going to have verses that have been written by Baba Farid, who was a Sufi saint. So, very interestingly, we see that religions are not in watertight compartments. There's actually fluidity amongst them, and people are absorbing this, appreciating this diversity, and actually living together in peace with each other. So I think we've also got a lot to learn when we look at history in this way. Long poems which were composed were known as masnavis, and a lot of times they were they expressed divine love. You may say they were a little too romanticized sometimes, but this divine love was important to show the connection between us mortals and the divine power. Allegory, so of course humans were used as allegory, and we have words such as prem or akhyan to describe a love story. One of the most famous of these stories which show love was the poem Padmavat by Malik Muhammad Jaisi, which revolved around the romance of Padmini and Ratan Singh of Chittor. You can be more familiar with this because I'm guessing a lot of you know that a movie starring Deepika Padukone had been released, Padmavat, and there was a lot of controversy around it. But it's important to understand when long back in the medieval times, and it's been inspired by this poem that was written by Malik Muhammad Jaisi, it's on the same lines. But it's important to understand how maybe we today could not bear to look at it, but long back, people very openly appreciated the poem as a work of art and creativity. So anyway, that the kind of love that poem shows, those kind of poems are very popular at the time period we're looking at. What about South India? Well, a lot of things were also being written in South India. We already had a look at Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. As far as creativity and literature is concerned, around Bijapur, which is Karnataka, short poems were written, and they were written in Dakhani. So, well, Deccan could in Hindi mean Dakhan, and then the language Dakhani. Now, these short poems were mostly sung by women as they did household chores. Luri Namas and Shadi Namas were very popular, where Shadi Nama would mean a song, would mean song sung during Shadi. Luri Nama would mean lullabies. Lullabies are songs sung especially to children in order to help them fall asleep. So they were very popular. In fact, they had a whole beat to them, and they were very easy songs. And a lot of times, when you're doing some work, you may just not realize but start humming a song. So a lot of times women, when they were doing chores in order to keep themselves entertained and go with a rhythmic flow, sung these songs. How are these songs inspired? Well, bhakti started before before Sufism. So we're guessing that they were definitely inspired by the bhakti compositions. Because remember, bhakti in South India was very popular. All right, thank you. We'll continue with the rest of the chapter in the later videos.